We live in a harsh and difficult world. This world of ours is filled with violence, hatred. It is torn by prejudice and parochialism. Insurmountable social and racial barriers have been erected that render the aspirations for a true brotherhood of men and a better future for mankind a mere figment of imagination, a wool gatherer's dream. People are greatly concerned about all this. But is there really anyone trying to solve some of these problems? People and events in our story rarely make front page news. They don't belong to the world of dazzling international diplomacy or awesome power games. Nevertheless, they do in their own way affect the world we live in, making life better for thousands of simple people separated by thousands of miles across the land and water. Our story, therefore, is about people brought together by the ideas of peace and love for other people. And the prime mover behind all their activity is the force of friendship. Perhaps the philosophy behind that effort is best expressed in a quotation from a Greek novelist, Nikos Kazantzakis. "And I strive to discover how to signal my companions, to say in time a simple word, a password like conspirators. Let us unite, let us hold each other tightly, let us merge our hearts, let us create for Earth a brain and a heart, let us give a human meaning to the superhuman struggle." Now, these ideas are shared by millions of people all over the world, but our story is just about one such effort, conceived by a missionary preacher while in the heart of Brazil. How did it all come about? What sort of man is he, whose name is just Smith? Who are you, Mr. Smith?
That's a very good question. I know who I am, and it's important to know who one is. It goes back to my religious belief. I'm a child of God. God has made me, and He's made me in His image. And having made me in His image, there's certain expectations that this Creator has of me. I am a child of God in the sense that I have responsibilities toward my Creator and toward myself and toward other people. So who am I? I'm a child of God. And being His child, I have a job to do in life. All of us have jobs to do. Sometimes they're a little bit different. Most of the times they are. And my job that my Creator has given me is to put people in touch with other people, to help build relationships. So I'm a bridge builder. I build bridges between people.
I have seen the goodbyes, where people cling to each other and love each other, and the barriers are broken down. Even a language barrier doesn't matter. And people get to really love each other. And so I don't see how that could help but add to peace and to a new world community. As people get to know each other and understand their customs and their habits and likes and dislikes. I just think the Friendship Force is one of the really great organizations in our country today, in our world today.
How did it happen that you started the Friendship Force, and when?
Oh, as I look back, it's a lot easier to understand than as I think about it now, but probably started from the time I was born in a small state of the United States, a very poor state called West Virginia. That's my home.
It was
similar to this.
Yeah, our house was a little bigger, but very humble house.
So, welcome to my house. The sweetest vision of my childhood was my mother and my brother and my sister. We didn't know that we were poor, because everyone was poor, but we were happy. And the older I got, the more I learned that things don't make you happy. It's people, people that you love that make you happy. My grandmother and my step-grandfather raised me, and my step-grandfather was the most wonderful man. He never had any children of his own. He married my grandmother after she was a widow, and she already had two children, my father and the woman who was my aunt. But when I was born, this step-grandfather, who was born in Italy and immigrated to the United States, And my grandmother, who was of Scotch-Irish descent, raised me from the time I was a small baby. And I simply remember them showering their affection and their love upon me. And there's no one who could love a son more than this Italian immigrant named Jimmy Muscatello loved me. And no son could love a father more than I love, still love. And I don't say it in the past tense. And I remember another time that he took me to see a live show of a magician.
Ladies and gentlemen, step right up. The show's about to begin. Magda the Magician is about to perform marvels your eyes have never seen. You, young man, step right this way. Watch this. Step right up, young man. Check it yourself. Open up the scarf and see. Voila!
My grandfather had a watch. I thought, well, I can do that.
Pipa, give me your watch and I'll show you a trick.
I opened it up. The watch was not intact. It was in pieces. But this wonderful man, instead of being very severe with me, thought it was very funny. And he, in fact, he bragged on me and complimented me for my creativity and my genius and my wanting to learn. But he told me that I'd better talk to the magician and learn how the trick was done rather than just do that in the future with any new watches he might purchase. Wonderful memories of childhood.
I met him when I was 16. I was in high school. He was a year older than I was, and we both played in the high school band. He played the trumpet, and I did too. But he was better than I was. He was real good. He sat in front of me. He played first trumpet, I played second trumpet, and that's how we met.
What do you think is the most valuable in life?
In the English language, a four-letter word. We sometimes talk disparagingly about four-letter words, but there are a lot of good four-letter words. And the most important one is L-O-V-E, love. That is the greatest force in the world. And there are different kinds of love, and one kind of love is friendship. It's the love of a person for a person. And that's what I do. I work in an organization called the Friendship Force. The force, the power of friendship.
Well, this is my office. I keep my books here, some of them. I have many more books that are in storage, and I've got to find a place for them. I love music, so I have many, many records here at the top, and tape recordings, books. These are books about the study of the Bible. Here's an interesting book. It's the Quran, and it was given to me by Muhammad Ali, the boxing champion. And he has a lovely inscription. To Brother Wayne Smith, from Brother Muhammad Ali. And then he said, death is so near, and time for friendly actions is so limited. Love and peace, always Ali.
What book do you think is the most important among all these books you have here?
I have no question. I can go to it immediately. It's this book. The Bible. For God so loved the world that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. That to me is the most important message in this wonderful book of the Bible. God loves the world, everybody, and he doesn't want us to perish, to die senselessly, And I'm not speaking just of physical death, we all die, but to die spiritually. He wants us to be alive, and he wants us to live eternally. And that word eternal for me means not only forever, but it means the depth and meaning of life. It's a wonderful book.
When I was living in Brazil with my wife and our four children, I was with the church at that time. I'm a Presbyterian minister by training and profession. That's my background. And that was my work there. I took them into some of these very humble homes. When I returned to the United States with my family in 1971, and I settled in the city of Atlanta, Georgia. It's not my hometown, but it's a wonderful, beautiful city. And I met a man who had just become our governor. He had a great big smile on his face. He had been working in peanuts down in a little city called Plains, Georgia. And his name, of course, is Jimmy Carter. And I liked them a lot, and I think they liked me and came to have a little confidence in me. And I began to tell especially Jimmy and Rosalind Carter about Brazil and my love for that country. And by April of 1972, it was agreed that we would make a trip to Brazil. I would be their interpreter, since I speak the language fluently, and introduce them to some of my friends, but not through the United States State Department. I said, let's do this on a people-to-people basis, as just human beings. And among the things that we did there was to visit some of the poor places that I had worked. I remember one man was a masseur. That was what he did for a living. And Jimmy Carter sat down in this very rustic house, and he really got involved in this man's life. Took his coat and his tie off, and we sat there and we had a cup of coffee in his home. He had had coffee with the president of the country, then he had coffee in the humble homes. Jimmy Carter became convinced that people-to-people diplomacy can be extremely effective.
During the campaign, even before Jimmy was elected president, Wayne wanted to see me one day, and I was busy campaigning, so I met him at the airport, and he said, when your husband is elected president, let's start a program like the Brazilian exchange in the whole world. And he had great dreams of airplanes taking off and people going and people coming and people in our country getting to know people in the whole world and breaking down the barriers that divide us.
Well, something very wonderful happened in 1976. Jimmy Carter was elected president of the United States. And I said, I've got another idea. He said, it doesn't surprise me, you've got more ideas than a dog's got fleas. He said, what do you want to do this time? I said, John Kennedy had a program called the Peace Corps. It's a wonderful program. Why don't you have a program called, not peace, but friendship, not corps, but force, the friendship force, but done differently, not with the American government paying for the program, but let the participants pay. Not just Americans who go out to some country for 2 years, but for Americans of all ages, even from little children to senior citizens who would go for 2 weeks, and the same airplane that takes these people bring back people from those countries. Let our symbol be two hands that clasp. He said, we'll do it. Rosalind Carter became our honorary chairperson, which she has been faithfully from the day that we started, which was March 1, 1977, because it was on that day that there was a dinner for all of the governors of the United States at the White House. The newly installed, inaugurated president of the United States was having these national leaders in, and they were wondering, well, what's he going to tell us at the end of the dinner? This is his first speech to us as the new president. And he stood and he said, I want to tell you about something that we're going to do. It's called the Friendship Force. And since that time, the Friendship Force has brought together in this way almost 2 million people from some 50 countries and about 300 communities around the world in every continent except Antarctica.
Well, Wayne Smith is one who understands that the political world and its decisions are basically predicated on relationships among people. Leaders really follow what the people want their country to do in many cases. And quite often, the international political borders divide people, one from another. Wayne is also a person who understands that a bold concept, one that's innovative and unprecedented and unpredictable and adventurous and idealistic is much more likely to be achieved than one that's very incremental and very modest in its dream. So I think that this knowledge that politics is really people and that boldness and a great dream is likely to be implemented is what has made the Friendship Force come into reality. One of the most vivid examples of this has been the new exchange that in the last few years between people in the Soviet Union and its republics on the one hand with people in our country. And this was not done after the Cold War was over. It was done when the Cold War was at an intense pitch and just beginning to fade away.
In 1981, I didn't know anybody in the Soviet Union. I couldn't even find a way to get into the Soviet Union. I had to come as a tourist, and that was not the easiest thing even in those days. And it was in 1981 that I arrived in Moscow and started knocking on doors. And from 1981 to 1991, lots of very good things have happened.
This winter, beginning in November, my organization plans to bring 25 people each week to Moscow. For 20 weeks, that'll be 500 people. And we want to take 25 Muscovites to my city of Atlanta, Georgia. That'll be 500 Muscovites over a period of 20 weeks. We want you to stay in our homes. We want to stay in your homes. And when we come, like friends do, we're going to bring you a present. We're going to bring you each 35 kilos of food to each family. That's not a lot, but it's an expression of our solidarity with you.
Yes, please. Hello. New friend.
Hello.
It's my daughter.
Daughter, wonderful. I have daughters too.
And in this way, we think that we'll have much more friendship and practical aid to a few families in Moscow with a few families in America.
My name is Terry Merriman, and I'm a news anchor at Channel 11 in Georgia, United States of America. And this is my trip here is with the Friendship Force to exchange culture, friendship, fellowship, to get to know each other as people, to embrace each other as human beings. And the more you learn about someone, the more chances there are for help, for peace, for understanding. And that's what this trip is all about.
Right here you can put some of your things, okay? And put here your dress.
My own TV set.
Yeah. Your TV set, yeah.
Okay. You can eat and open the refrigerator and drink what would you want, like, and drink everything for you, like at home, please.
Okay. Statue of Liberty.
Oh, thank you very much.
Thank you
very
much.
Thank you
for having me.
Thank you.
It looks marvelous on you.
Hi, I'm Jean Ann Miller from Atlanta, Georgia, and this is my new family. This is Dmitry from here in Moscow. He's my new brother.
Come on in. Hello. A surprise visit, isn't it? My name is Dmitry Silvestrov. I'm a translator of poetry and fiction and essay writing into the Russian language. We subscribe to Currenty newspaper, and in this newspaper, I saw the announcement about the Friendship Force together with the application form. I wrote the application and sent it to the Friendship Force and learned that they will be picking up host families according to the application. The next day they invited us to the Friendship Force, and the same day told us that the guest of my family would be arriving the following day. I was very, very excited. I didn't have much time to prepare, but nevertheless everything went just fine. Nowadays, the attitude of the West to Russia and what used to be the Soviet Union is of historic importance. It will definitely become a part of history. It will not be forgotten. What the Friendship Force is doing is a part of it, a very significant part. When I was meeting the Friendship Force group at the airport, I learned that the Americans are bringing food with them, humanitarian kind of aid. At this time, when we were going through tremendous difficulties, I was not a bit excited, I realized, about the food problem. What was the most interesting for me was what kind of person my guest would turn out to be. How would she look? This is the most interesting part of the experience. Nothing is more interesting than the human dimension.
Now, won't he make a good American Santa Claus?
Американский.
But that one's better.
Да, yes. And the Russian vodka
is better.
Yes.
Yes. Yeah. I like the lemonade better, vodka.
This is a very special family because it's my family now. And when I arrived here on Saturday, I didn't know any of them. And when I came through the crowd, there was a sign with my name on it with a big smiling face behind it. And then I met their daughter, Galasha. By the way, that was Dmitri. And it seems like we've been friends for many, many years. We're age-wise, we're a year apart, just less than a year. And so we've had a wonderful time sharing experiences of our growing up when our countries were friends and fought together during periods of time where our countries were enemies, and now coming back to where we can be friends again. And neither one of us ever expected that we would visit each other's countries and that we would have friends from each other's countries. So this has been rather unique.
Friendship
has no borders.
No borders. Не имеет границ.
We will be only too happy to invite all of your family to visit us. I know it's going to be a little problem because we can hardly accommodate all of you, but we'll get by somehow. I wish that our friendship will last forever and we stay friends for the rest of our lives.
Now tell me in English.
We were received at the Friendship Society in Moscow, and it was a wonderful reception, and I can see it as though it was yesterday. Those were different days back in 1982, very different atmosphere, and it seemed that because we had other visits of this nature after, and they all repeated the same thing, it seemed as though someone had been designated in every group among the Soviets to welcome us with a speech. And the speech was almost laughable at that time. You know, welcome to our country, you who are peace-loving Americans. And we would sit and think, well, peace-loving? Well, aren't we all peace-loving in America? Do we have warmongers in our group? They would go on and say, we're happy that you peace-loving Americans have come, and we are very sorry that you have for your president someone who does not want peace, but is trying to provoke us and cause war to come about. And this enraged us internally as we would hear these comments. I would stand and I would say, now we don't talk to our president every day about world affairs. If you talk to your leader, you know, you tell him we don't want any wars, and we don't think you do either. We're here to find out other things. For example, I would say to a person, sir, do you have a dog? He'd say, a dog? We need here in this meeting to ask me if I have a dog. Yes, I want to know, do you have a dog? I have two dogs. He'd say, well, yes, I have a dog. Well, what's your dog's name? And he would tell me, well, what does your dog eat? Do you love your dog? And I said, now you see what we're doing. We're trying to establish a point of contact where we have something in common. You have a dog, I have a dog, you love your dog, I love my dog. So why don't we start with that we have in common instead of talking about warmongers and your president and your national leader? Because you see, when two people meet from two backgrounds such as ours, and we start off just with what's in our heads, we already have our minds made up. All we're doing is arguing. You want to win the argument, I want to win the argument. No one will win the argument. You will not change my mind, I will not change your mind. Let's start in our hearts about something we both love. Well, that started in 1982, and then it really got going in 1985.
Well, 1985 was a turning point indeed in the evolution of the movement. the waves of friendship force are reaching the welcoming shores of the rapidly changing Soviet Union. There was an overall endorsement of its conceptual framework and practical activity by the high-ranking politicians like the Foreign Minister Edward Shevardnadze. Eminent ophthalmologist Professor Sviatoslav Fyodorov, a member of the International Advisory Council, has discussed with the governor of the state of Georgia, Zell Miller, the opportunities for future cooperation. Soviet Foreign Minister Edward Shevardnadze, who personifies the new thinking approach to international relations, has agreed to become a member of the Friendship Forces International Advisory Council. Mr. Shevardnadze spoke about the newly inaugurated Friend-to-Friend program under the auspices of Friendship Force, a program especially designed and tailored for the Soviet Union. The foreign minister has highly evaluated the program's most salient features of solidarity and unequivocal moral support given by the American people to the dramatic transformations affecting the very grain and texture of life in the Soviet Union. These momentous changes, occurring at the critical juncture of the country's historical development, will, in Shevardnadze's opinion, have repercussions in all parts of the world, radically altering our perception of reality and preparing mankind for the biggest challenge of building a community of states based on cooperation and goodwill.
That have differences in traditions, that have differences in language, that have differences in custom, being able to learn about one another and being able to appreciate each other's differences. And so I think it will be even greater than it has been in the past.
Wayne Smith is a wonderful person. He has found this absolutely unique human element in establishing people's relationships, bypassing government institutions or state structures. The true friendship between people, a feeling of spontaneous trust among total strangers, is so heartwarming and exceptionally important. It is especially significant for people coming from so distinctly different cultures as yours and ours. People can really move mountains if they make an effort. This passion for achievement can break all barriers. Even fascist regimes could be crumbled, or a semi-fascist regime that had existed in our country for 73 years.
Beautiful instrument, most effective instrument, and most human instrument. For future, because people will understand, only this instrument can open every door.
And let us drink for Mr. Wayne Smith! Gip, gip!
Hurrah!
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 I'm still learning. Life's taught me a lot. Life's taught me that it's beautiful, it's wonderful, it's good, but there's evil in it. There are bad things. There's the good and the bad, the bitter and the sweet. Life has taught me that the most important things about life are relationships with people and with God. First, with God. I have priorities in life. I don't always follow them, but I know what they are and I try to follow them. And the first priority is my relationship with my Maker, with my Creator. Because if I'm not in a right, proper relationship with God, then nothing goes right for me. I saw that the world is much bigger than this church building, and I had the idea that I needed to be in the world far beyond this church, as well as in this church, to tell people the same message. It's the message that God really does exist, that God loves all of the people that He's made, and that God wants us to live together as friends, to cooperate with each other as brothers and sisters, to live in a world that can be a wonderful world, if we'll let it be, or can be a hell, if we insist on making it that.
And I'm Terry Merriman, here in Moscow. And I'm Terry Merriman. Nowhere is the importance of religion more evident than here in beautiful Zagorsk. Wonderful people, lifelong friends now. Now every time I hear news about Russia, I will think about Oksana and her family and hope that they are doing well and that they're happy. Whenever there is happy news out of Russia, I will be happy for her. And whenever there is sad news, I will worry about her. And I think if everyone in America had a chance to do this, just imagine what kind of implications on world peace that would have. It would be amazing.
This has been a wonderful experience for me. Together with Terry, I was kind of looking at our lives through Terry's eyes, and I have discovered quite a few interesting things. It has been very exciting. I might say a revelation for me. I'm happy you met and became friends, and I hope our friendship will grow and last forever.
And now I'm very glad that she is very interesting and very pleasant, very friendly to us, and we are friends forever now.
The hospitality which you are giving us is very gracious, and we thank you for it. When I look around the room, my heart is filled with happiness. You have been so generous to go as your host, as being host, and bring so much to us, and we feel very humbled by it. We're visiting with you, and we thank you. So our purpose is to be here in friendship. One of the few words in Russian that I know, druzhba. That's why we're here.
First present. Well, I can't remember, maybe, probably flowers. He used to give me flowers all the time. Beautiful roses. I loved roses. And he would always sign someone else's name to the card. That was always so funny. I would get these beautiful roses and I would open the card and it would say, "Love from Maximilian." Maximilian? Who is Maximilian? Sometimes he would say, "Love, Max." And one day, you know, I said, "Wayne, are you sending me these flowers?" He said, "What flowers? I'm not sending you flowers." I said, "Well, I'm getting these gorgeous roses, and it says Max or Maximilian." He said, "Do you have another boyfriend?" I said, "No." He's always joked a lot.
There are hundreds or maybe thousands of pretty women around Wayne.
Yeah, all the time.
Do you ever feel jealous?
Well, I have to admit I do sometimes, yeah. But not really. More irritated, I think he would. I get more irritated because I never worry about him. He is the most loyal, trustworthy person I've ever met in my life.
I
I now declare, as president of our organization, that the 15th International Conference of the Friendship Force is open. Thank you for having us here.
Over 500 Friendship Force family members from 20 countries and 26 U.S. states gathered at the 15th Annual International Conference in Daytona Beach, Florida. An attitude of caring and compassion, a sense that people can really make a difference in the lives of others, was underlined by the board chairman, Jim Wise. To demonstrate this sense of compassion, Chairman Wise announced that the Friendship Force is creating a Good Neighbor Club Development Fund with a goal of $20,000 to assist clubs in those countries that are facing particularly severe economic hardships. Each year, the fund will focus its efforts on a different region of the world. For 1992, the priority target region will be the countries of Eastern and Central Europe. Among the delegates who received special welcomes during the conference were 13 representatives of 5 Friendship Force clubs in Eastern and Central Europe, from Hungary, Czechoslovakia, and Bulgaria. The highlight of the conference was a fundraising campaign to purchase a taxicab in Rio de Janeiro for the Brazilian taxicab driver, Mr. Gilberto Moraes.
We can't help everyone in Brazil, but we can help you. And remember, you have to help somebody. What can you do? He thought, and he said, well, if I have my own automobile, I will make a pledge that anytime anyone in my community is sick and needs to go to the hospital, they can call me 24 hours a day, and I will take them to the hospital, no charge. I said, well, not just you, but what about your children and your wife? He said, well, my children know how to read and write. Many people don't. Each one of them will find one person they can teach to read or write.
Que me ajudaram de um modo geral.
And all of you who have helped me, I say thank you.
E espero a todos que me ajudaram quando for ao Rio de Janeiro para andar no meu táxi.
And I want to make you an invitation. All of you who have helped me, when you come to Rio de Janeiro, call me. I want to help you. Driving you around in my taxi. We are human beings.
E a atmosfera da amizade.
And we live together in an atmosphere of friendship.
Modificou a vida de Gilberto Barbosa.
It's changed the life of Gilberto Barbosa.
E milhões neste mundo nos esperam.
And millions more in this world wait for our touch.
Porque há uma luz brilhante.
Because there's a light that's shining.
Namaste.
Namaste. Let us sing our concluding song, and with it we'll be finished.
Friendship Follies put the finishing touch on a conference, a veritable smorgasbord of folk dancing and singing, representing countries and cultures thousands of miles apart. Apart from being colleagues, we have been close friends with Wayne for decades now. So I consider Wayne as one of those great, unique individuals who strive to make our world a better place to live. It is a pleasure, an honor, and a great privilege to work with Wayne, who has really turned Friendship Force into a creative workshop of people-to-people diplomacy.
That time, I don't know that Mr. Wayne Smith. Now, after 10 years, I understand this, you know, ever is. What type of the person? He speaks different languages. He has a lot of experiences in many different cultures. So he's a great man.
He's just one of the nicest and kindest people I've ever met, but I'm sure there are others too. But he's got a certain aura about him, almost like like a saint, like he walks around with the halo and the icons.
And the more we know about people, not just in the Soviet Union, but in nations of Africa, among refugees, in the Middle East, in a troubled region, or in Asia, the more we can extend the advantages of the end of the Cold War to a better life for all of us. And I see the Friendship Force playing an increasing role in making this possible.
We have four that will be like that. Four. We got one for Wayne, one for me.
Nice, Marta.
Okay.
Get up off the ground, or you're gonna get sick.
Come back.
Are you scared
Vampire.
About this?
Vampire.
No. No time.
No. Never.
Never. Are you, Caroline?
No.
No fear.
Not at all.
I don't like the process.
Yes.
It's like, am I afraid to go to Moscow?
No.
But I don't like to ride the airplane to get there. But in Moscow is good. It's no problem. Same way with death.
No problem. Do you believe in paradise?
Heaven.
Heaven.
Only heaven. Heaven.
I hope that's where I go.
I'm already in heaven, right now.
If Wayne were far away, you would say what?
I wish you were here. We're having a great time without you.
I like best when he just started singing. It's called Unforgettable, and Nat King Cole sang it, and now his daughter's singing it on tape along with him. And hopefully my father and I will record that together. And it's called Unforgettable. That's what you are. And I feel that way about my father very much, and I think he thinks that way about me too.
Unforgettable in every way. And forevermore, that's how you'll stay. That's why, darling, it's incredible that someone so unforgettable thinks that I am unforgettable too. Thinks that I am Unforgettable.